William Morrow and Harper Audio present American Entrepreneur, How 400 Years of Risk-Takers, Innovators, and Business Visionaries Built the USA, by Willie Robertson and William Doyle, read by Brian Holsopple. Author's Note. One day not long ago, I decided to write a book about how family businesses and entrepreneurs like my family and millions of others have helped build and shape America. So I huddled up with my buddy and co-author, William Doyle. We got to doing lots of talking and lots of researching, and before you knew it, we came across a whole bunch of stories about great American entrepreneurs. And the audiobook you're about to hear was born. We hope you like it. Prologue: An American Family Business. Diligent hands will rule. Proverbs chapter 12, verse 24. As long as there's been an America, there have been entrepreneurs. We started businesses on our kitchen tables and living room couches and in our backyards, farms, and garages. Sometimes we started with nothing, and sometimes we got a stack of seed money from a friendly bank or family member. We sweat, strain, cry, laugh, and work our tails off to make something from nothing and build a better life for our families and ourselves. Sometimes we've gone bust, and sometimes we've succeeded far beyond our wildest dreams. Even the biggest companies start out small, and we're the ones who started them. In the process, we founded this nation, built it into the world's economic superpower, and inspired the world with our achievements. America has always been a land of business visionaries, risk-takers, and doers, of growers, makers, wheeler-dealers, traders, sellers, merchants, and go-getters. American economist William Baumol described an entrepreneur as the individual willing to embark on adventure in pursuit of economic goals. Management expert Peter Drucker described entrepreneurship as the act that endows resources with a new capacity to create wealth. According to historian John Steele Gordon, the first patent awarded to an American resident was given to Joseph Jenks in 1646 for a device that improved the manufacture of edged tools, such as sickles. It was the beginning of the Yankee ingenuity that has characterized American economy ever since, from that first machine tool to bifocal glasses, the cotton gin, automated flour mills, the high-pressure steam engine, interchangeable parts, the McCormick Reaper, the oil industry, the airplane, Coca-Cola, the affordable automobile, the digital computer, and Twitter. America was founded, fed, financed, nurtured, and sustained in large part by entrepreneurs. The spirit of America is the spirit of entrepreneurship, of risk, innovation, ingenuity, grit, and perseverance. The history of America is largely the history of businesses, most of which started out small and sometimes stayed that way, but sometimes grew far beyond the wildest dreams of their founders. My inspiration is God, my family is my life, and my business is my family. I am the CEO of a family business that my father started 46 years ago in a dilapidated backyard shed when we had nothing except a life of dirt-poor poverty. It's a business that my mother helped run, my brothers and I grew up in, and my wife, in-laws, and extended family and friends have helped build into a multi-million dollar powerhouse. Today, that business has launched three successful TV shows, including Duck Dynasty, the most-watched reality TV show in history, sold tens of millions of dollars of products and merchandise, generated hundreds of jobs, and entertained and inspired many millions of people the world over. But our American dream started out smack in the middle of an American nightmare. My father, Phil, grew up not far from where we all live today, in a house with no running water and no electricity and a toilet 200 feet back in the woods. He attended Louisiana Tech on a football scholarship, started as quarterback over Super Bowl champion-to-be Terry Bradshaw, smoked dope and listened to lots of Jimi Hendrix, married my mother, Miss Kay, when she was 18 years old and he was 20, got a master's degree in education, then decided he'd rather hunt ducks than be a teacher. To supplement the family income and just barely scratch out a living, Phil became a commercial fisherman, selling his own net-caught flathead catfish for 70 cents a pound. One day in 1972, the year I was born, Phil had an idea. He was fed up with the store-bought duck calls he used during duck hunting season. "These things don't sound at all like real ducks," he thought. "I can build a better duck call." So he disappeared into the ramshackle work shed in the back of our property and started tinkering around with materials and tools. Weeks went by. Eventually, he worked out a sweet design made of two separate cedar tree-cut reeds rather than the usual one, plus the ingenious twist of carving a dimple in the reeds to hold them separate. It was a design so special that he got a patent for it. He put a lot of hard work and patience into his duck call. He just wanted to make a great duck call for the average hunter. The result was the backwoods Stradivarius of duck calls, a duck call that sounded more like a duck than a duck did, a sound that reached far up in the sky and invited ducks to come on down, relax, and spend some quality time with new friends, who actually turned out to be the business end of a shotgun. Ducks loved the sweet music the instrument made, and so did the hunters. To buy a lathe and other gear, Phil took out a $25,000 loan from the Howards, a family of successful local retail entrepreneurs, who eventually became my in-laws, and started cranking out duck calls one by one. My mom pitched in to run the business, handling orders, paying the bills, and balancing the books on the living room couch. Phil and Miss Kay laid the foundation for our family's success. That first year, they made $8,000, and the Duck Commander Company was born. A business was born. Then disaster struck. Just as the duck call business was slowly taking off, Phil decided to make Satan his business partner. There's no other way to describe what happened to him. Phil chugged whiskey straight from the bottle, came home drunk, got in fights, operated a honky-tonk, and kicked the family out of our trailer home for a while. One night he got in a fight with the honky-tonk's owner and his wife, beat up both of them, and threw the lady clear across the bar. He snuck out the back door to escape the police and hid out in the woods to evade the long arm of the law. He spent most of the next 8 years as a full-blown heathen, and my parents' marriage started falling apart. One day, a minister showed up out of the blue, gave my dad a Bible, and told him to put his life in the hands of Jesus. My father turned him down. Until 4 months later, when he decided it was a really good idea. He begged Miss Kay to take him back, and she did, provided that he stop drinking, lose his old friends, and put his life in the hands of the Lord. He did, and has led a clean life ever since. As a family, we turned all those mistakes and negative energy into a positive, and we built our business on it. I've always been entrepreneurial. In fifth grade, I was constantly selling and trading things. We were so poor I didn't have an allowance. I needed cash. I had a pretty productive worm farm, and I sold bait worms to the local fishermen every Saturday morning. I filled one of my dad's old boats with cow manure and put every worm I could find in it. One day, one of my dad's hunting friends, who was a candy distributor, gave me a box of Hubba Bubba bubble gum. This created a dilemma for me. I wanted to consume the entire box, but then I thought, well, what if I sold this gum to other kids? I took a pack on my school bus, offered each stick for 50 cents apiece, and sold out before we got to school. I thought, we got something here. We got a real business. I got my mom to drive me to the cash and carry store, loaded up on inventory, and it wasn't long before I was a full-fledged candy dealer. I did candy deals on the bus, out of my locker, out of my coat. I was practically dealing on the street corner. Pretty soon, I had made hundreds of dollars, which to me was a small fortune. I was like Red in Shawshank Redemption. I was the guy who could get stuff. I did special orders. I had repeat customers. I even offered revolving credit plans. I was rolling in cash, and I enjoyed living the high life as a 10-year-old. I bought a new pair of sneakers and strolled around like a prize peacock. My fifth-grade teacher called me the little tycoon. Business was going wonderfully. Then I got called into the principal's office. Willie, are you selling gum and candy out of your locker? I said, yeah, and I'm doing pretty good at it, too. He said, well, I've had a meeting with the school concession stand, and their sales are way down. So I'm going to shut you down. No more selling stuff at school. I was crushed. Now I was desperate for money, since I'd grown accustomed to that lifestyle. I thought, what else can I do to make money? For a while, I sold pencils and erasers. For 50 cents, I'd entertain you by popping a June bug in my mouth and eating it raw as a snack. Then I came up with an idea that I thought was pretty genius, the human jukebox. We had a long bus ride to school, and I thought, what if I entertained people and they paid me money? So I announced my new career as the human jukebox and popped up on the back of the school bus seat. Kids would stick a quarter under my arm like I was a jukebox. I'd robotically put the quarter in my pocket, and I'd sing whatever song you wanted to hear. I'd sing all the vocal parts and do the instruments, too. My specialties were Michael Jackson, the Beach Boys, and Molly Hatchet tunes. But my most popular song by far was Jukebox Hero by Foreigner. Those fifth-grade girls loved it. Norma Jean, the bus driver, would look in her rear-view mirror and say, Willie, get your butt down off that seat. So I'd just crouch down low and keep singing the whole way. The human jukebox didn't make as much money as my gum business, but it was still pretty lucrative. By trade, neither my father nor my mother was a business person. Dad had an education degree and Mom had a GED. Neither was great at math, and they had little experience in business. Dad was not really a good worker, didn't have a lot of tools, had no money to speak of, and was paying the bills by commercial fishing, which ain't easy. As soon as we kids could pitch in to help the family business, we all did. As the duck call business slowly grew, Dad was the constant motivational speaker to all of us employees, which in the early days consisted of us four brothers, Alan, Jace, Jep, and me, and Miss Kay. It was a first-hand account of how to start a business, how to run a business, and how to work like crazy to make sure it succeeds. My father would do simple math. If there are 2 million duck hunters and we got just 10% to buy our duck call, then we would sell 200,000 duck calls. I don't recommend this to the young folks out there, but my father actually encouraged my brother Jason and me to skip school to pitch in and help the family business. We would skip the maximum number of days possible from school without failing, which was 40 back then. We did all the jobs. The worst job of all was to fill catfish traps with socks hand-stuffed with rotten cheese scooped out of a 55-gallon drum. We didn't get paid for our work, though. Dad would always say, well, you're getting to eat tonight. He wouldn't ever pay for worms or bait, either. Crawfish will eat anything, he said. Snakes, other fish, they'll eat you if you lay out there long enough. So if there was a recent roadkill and you could bear the smell, we would take that varmint or whatever it was and I'd chop it up into little pieces and we'd throw it into the crawfish trap. It's free bait, my dad would say. I also sold German carp on the street corner. German carp doesn't sound very appetizing, and it's not the world's tastiest fish. So I borrowed a trick from my dad and called it.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.